Hello everyone, this is Anthony Chan. Welcome to the fifth lecture of my lecture series on essential medical liver pathology for trainees and any pathologists interested in liver pathology. The previous lecture covered three histological patterns under the category of hepatic injury, including the acute hepatic necrotic pattern, the acute hepatitic pattern, and the resolving acute hepatitic pattern. Let's get started on the remaining pattern under this category. The portal inflammation pattern is a broad category and can be further stratified into subpatterns according to the predominant cellular component in the portal tract. The first subpattern is lymphocyte-predominant portal inflammation. This portal tract is expanded by a moderate amount of inflammation, predominantly composed of lymphocytes. This portal tract is expanded by a moderate inflammatory infiltrate primarily composed of lymphocytes, along with a reactive lymphoid follicle. Portal inflammation of this type is commonly linked to chronic viral hepatitis, autoimmune hepatitis, and chronic biliary disease. Still, it can also be seen in various other conditions, including drug-induced liver injury. Portal lymphoid follicles are a distinctive feature of chronic hepatitis C, but they can also be present in various other liver diseases, including chronic hepatitis B, autoimmune hepatitis, and primary biliary cholangitis. To make a definitive diagnosis, it is crucial to identify other associated features. The portal tract in this example shows mild lymphocyte predominant inflammation. If we identify ground glass hepatocytes, which might be further confirmed by Eosin stain or immunohistochemistry for hepatitis B surface antigen, we could establish a definite diagnosis of chronic hepatitis B. The portal tract of another example contains lymphocyte predominant inflammation with a reactive lymphoid follicle. If we further identify mild bile duct injury, bead-like sinusoidal lymphocytic infiltrate, and mild macrovesicular steatosis, we can readily conclude this is a classic case of chronic hepatitis C. In this example, the portal tract is also expanded by lymphocyte predominant infiltrate. If we recognize a florid duct lesion, ductopenia, and chronic colloid stasis, we could secure a diagnosis of primary biliary cholangitis in a patient with elevated alkaline phosphatase or seropositivity for AMA. This example also demonstrates lymphocyte predominant portal inflammation as well as interface hepatitis. If emporopolysis and hepatocyte rosette formation are revealed, the overall histological picture is typical for autoimmune hepatitis. Certainly, we have to correlate with serum immunoglobulin and autoantibodies. The next subpattern is plasma cell-rich portal inflammation. This portal tract is significantly expanded by plasma cell-rich inflammatory infiltrate. Plasma cell-rich portal inflammation is typically associated with immune-mediated liver diseases such as autoimmune hepatitis, primary biliary cholangitis, and IgG4-related liver disease. Other less common causes of this inflammation pattern include acute hepatitis A and B, drug-induced liver injury, lymphoma, and plasma cell neoplasm. Prominent interface hepatitis is another subpattern of portal inflammation. Prominent interface hepatitis is demonstrated here by multifocal interface hepatitis breaching the parenchymal-mesenchymal interface. How do we define prominent interface hepatitis? Let's see how we assess the severity of interface hepatitis, i.e. grade the interface hepatitis. A mild degree is characterized by focal interface hepatitis breaching the portal lobular interface. A moderate degree involves multifocal interface hepatitis affecting less than 50% of the circumference of most portal tracts. A marked degree indicates extensive interface hepatitis affecting more than 50% of the circumference of most portal tracts. Prominent interface hepatitis means the presence of moderate or marked interface hepatitis. This is an example showing prominent interface hepatitis. Although prominent interface hepatitis is typically regarded as a hallmark feature of autoimmune hepatitis, it can be observed in any acute or chronic hepatitis with high disease activity. This includes drug-induced liver injury and chronic viral hepatitis with high activity, especially among immunocompromised patients. Let's briefly discuss the diagnosis of autoimmune hepatitis. Professional organizations in Europe, the United States, and mainland China recommend that histological examination is necessary for diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis. The revised International Autoimmune Hepatitis Group Scoring System is a set of criteria used to diagnose autoimmune hepatitis. It combines clinical, biochemical, serological, and histological data to provide a score that helps determine the likelihood of autoimmune hepatitis. Key histological features include interface hepatitis, lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate, hepatocyte rosettes, and the absence of biliary changes. While this revised scoring system is an excellent tool for research purposes, its complexity and comprehensiveness make it less practical for daily clinical use. The simplified International Autoimmune Hepatitis Group Scoring System was developed to provide a more practical tool for diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis that can be easily used in daily clinical practice. This system is less complex and time-consuming compared to the revised scoring system while still maintaining diagnostic accuracy. Histology remains one of four key criteria of this simplified system. The term typical of autoimmune hepatitis in the simplified system refers to the presence of a portal lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate with interface hepatitis, hepatocyte rosettes, and empyrobolysis. However, various studies have shown that these histological features are not highly sensitive or specific for diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis. Furthermore, it should be noted that hepatocyte rosette is not a sensitive indicator, while empyrobolysis is neither sensitive nor specific for diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis. Hence, recent histological criteria emphasize portal lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate more than mild interface hepatitis and more than mild lobular inflammation, while hepatocyte rosettes and empyrobolysis are no longer considered. However, we should remember that histology is only one of the parameters in diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis. Clinical, serological, and pathological correlation are essential for an accurate diagnosis. Eosinophil-rich inflammation is the sub-pattern of portal inflammation we're going to discuss. This portal tract is expanded by an inflammatory infiltrate that includes a significant number of eosinophils. Another example highlights a substantial number of eosinophils within the portal inflammatory infiltrate. Parasitic infestation and drug-induced liver injury should be considered when eosinophil-rich portal inflammation is observed. Other less common differential diagnoses include inflammatory pseudotumor, IPT-like follicular dendritic cell tumor, Hodgkin lymphoma, and Langerhans cell histiocytosis. However, it should be noted that the presence of a few scattered eosinophils in the portal tract is quite nonspecific and commonly observed in a variety of liver diseases. Let's move on to discussing neutrophil-rich portal inflammation. A significant number of neutrophils are accompanied by ductular proliferation. This mixed portal inflammation consists of many neutrophils. An interlobular bile duct is infiltrated and distended by neutrophils, indicating acute cholangitis. Neutrophils are commonly associated with proliferating bile ductules and are a component of the ductular reaction. Portal neutrophils alone do not diagnose acute biliary obstruction, which should also have a prominent ductular reaction, portal edema, and acute cholangitis if present. Last but not least is the portal granuloma or granulomatous inflammation. There is a non-caseating epithelioid granuloma present in a portal tract. An unpaired hepatic artery is observed without an accompanying interlobular bile duct. In this portal tract, there is a vague non-caseating epithelioid granuloma. This table outlines the primary differential diagnosis for portal granuloma, which may have infectious or non-infectious origins. Important non-infectious causes to consider include primary biliary cholangitis, drug-induced liver injury, and sarcoidosis. This is an example of primary biliary cholangitis, characterized by a non-caseating epithelioid granuloma within a portal tract, a mildly damaged bile duct, and a dense chronic inflammatory infiltrate of lymphocytes, plasma cells, and histiocytes. This is an example of trifluoprazine-induced liver injury. The portal tract is significantly expanded by a lymphohistiocytic and granulomatous infiltrate featuring multinucleated giant cells. This liver biopsy is from a patient with hepatic sarcoidosis showing multiple non-caseating epithelioid granulomas within a portal tract. After thoroughly examining the various patterns associated with hepatitic injury, it is now time to shift our focus toward another significant category of liver pathology, cholestatic injury. The first pattern of cholestatic injury is known as the bland cholestatic pattern. This pattern features varying degrees of lobular cholestasis, yet it notably lacks significant necroinflammatory activity or fibrosis. Certainly, bile duct injury and ductopenia should be absent. significant hepatocellular and canalicular bilirubinostasis is observed, occurring without notable inflammatory activity. Drug-induced liver injury is the major consideration for the bland cholestatic pattern. Other differential diagnoses include sepsis, shock, paraneoplastic syndrome, intrahepatic cholestasis or pregnancy, and familial disorders of bile acid transporter. This table highlights those drugs and toxins inducing bland cholestasis. The second pattern of cholestatic injury is known as the acute cholestatic hepatic pattern. It is distinguished by prominent lobular cholestasis with moderate necroinflammatory activity at most, and no fibrosis. In comparison to the acute hepatitic pattern, this pattern shows more pronounced cholestasis but significantly less necroinflammatory activity. Additionally, bridging and panacinar necrosis are rarely observed in the acute cholestatic hepatitic pattern. Perivenular confluent necrosis is accompanied by marked hepatocellular and canalicular cholestasis. Hepatocellular and canalicular cholestasis are observed alongside confluent necrosis and regenerating hepatocytes. The primary cause of the acute cholestatic hepatic pattern is drug-induced liver injury. However, this pattern can also be observed in cases of autoimmune hepatitis and acute hepatopic viral hepatitis, particularly viral hepatitis A. This table provides different drugs and toxins associated with the acute cholestatic hepatitic pattern. The next type of cholestatic injury is the acute biliary obstructive pattern. This pattern is seldom observed in liver biopsies because it is typically diagnosed through imaging and cholangiogram. It is distinguished by a pronounced ductular reaction, portal inflammation rich in neutrophils, and portal edema. Acute cholangitis may also be present, characterized by the accumulation of neutrophils within a distended bile duct. The degree of lobular cholestasis can range from minimal to marked. The prominent ductular reaction is associated with neutrophil-rich portal inflammation, portal edema, and acute cholangitis. Typical histological features of acute biliary obstruction are demonstrated in this excisional specimen from a patient with perihilar cholangiocarcinoma. This histological pattern is clearly indicative of acute biliary obstruction, regardless of the cause. However, progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis pyphic type 3 should also be considered, particularly in older children, teenagers, and even young adults. Let's proceed to the final pattern of cholestatic injury, known as the chronic cholestatic pattern. This pattern is characterized by portal-based inflammation, bile duct damage, ductopenia, chronic cholestasis, and portal-based fibrosis. A portal tract exhibits a damaged bile duct with epithelial disarray and a lymphocytic infiltrate, accompanied by a marked plasma cell-rich portal inflammation. This portal tract features a florid duct lesion, characterized by a damaged interlobular bile duct surrounded by a dense lymphohistiocytic infiltrate. A portal tract displays an unpaired hepatic artery lacking its accompanying interlobular bile duct. Additionally, a prominent ductular reaction is present. The presence of copper-associated protein in periportal hepatocytes indicates chronic cholestasis, signifying prolonged retention of bile acids and salts in hepatocytes due to persistent impairment of bile flow. Feathery degeneration is another histological indicator of chronic cholestasis. Cytokeratin 7 immunostaining highlights bile ductules and many periportal hepatocytes. Normally, hepatocytes do not exhibit immunoreactivity to CK7. Aberrant expression of CK7 in hepatocytes may indicate transdifferentiation into cholangiocytes biliary metaplasia or dedifferentiation into hepatic progenitor cells. CK7-positive hepatocytes are found in various liver diseases and are associated with regenerative activity. Periportal CK7-positive hepatocytes are commonly linked to cholestatic conditions and can be considered a sensitive, though non-specific, marker of cholestasis. The major and common considerations for the chronic cholestatic pattern are primary biliary cholangitis, primary sclerosing cholangitis, EG4-related sclerosing cholangitis, and drug-induced liver injury. This table lists various drugs and toxins associated with the chronic cholestatic pattern. Many of these are also linked to the acute cholestatic hepatitis pattern. Let's briefly discuss the diagnosis of primary biliary cholangitis. According to the American Association for the Study of Liver Diseases AASLD, at least two of the following three criteria must be satisfied: elevated alkaline phosphatase levels, seropositivity for antimitochondrial antibodies AMA, and histological evidence of chronic non-suppurative destructive cholangitis with interlobular bile duct destruction. The European Association for the Study of the Liver recommends that PBC can be diagnosed in adult patients with cholestasis if they have elevated alkaline phosphatase and the presence of ALMA, provided there is no indication of systemic disease. In contrast to autoimmune hepatitis, both professional organizations advise against using liver biopsy as a routine diagnostic tool for most patients with suspected PBC. Liver biopsy should be considered only for patients who have unexplained intrahepatic cholestasis after undergoing serological screening and comprehensive imaging examinations. Thank you for attending another lecture in my series on essential medical liver pathology. I hope the material we covered today provided valuable insights and practical knowledge that you can apply in your clinical practice. Your ongoing commitment to learning and participation in these lectures is deeply appreciated. I look forward to seeing you in our next session. Until then, take care and keep up the great work.